2 Chronicles chapter 20. We're going to read verses 1 to 30. It's a lot to read, but I want to read it because I've read it a whole lot. You guys maybe haven't read this chapter in a while. I want the whole thing fresh in your mind. So, 2 Chronicles 20, verse 1. After this, after a small reformation, after this, the Moabites and the Ammonites, and with them some of the Meunites, came against Jehoshaphat for battle. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A great multitude is coming against you from Edom, from beyond the sea, and behold, they are in Hazon Tamar," that is in Gedi. So we kind of see the context. A great multitude is coming against Judah for war. Verse 3. Then Jehoshaphat was afraid. What are you doing? You're afraid. And set his face to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. And Judah assembled to seek help from the Lord. From all the cities of Judah they came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah in Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, so this is his prayer we're about to read. O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. In your hand are power and might, so that none is able to withstand you. Did you not, our God, drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? And they have lived in it and have built for you in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this house and before you, for your name is in this house, and cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save. And now behold, he's still praying, the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, whom you would not let Israel invade when they came from the land of Egypt, and whom they avoided and did not destroy. Behold, they reward us by coming to drive us out of your possession, which you have given to us to inherit. O our God, will you not execute judgment on them? For we are powerless against this great horde that comes against us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. That's his prayer. What happens after he prays? Verse 13, meanwhile, all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, their children. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehazel, the son of Zechariah, son of Benaiah, son of Jael, son of Matanai, and a Levite of the sons of Asaph in the midst of the assembly. And he said, listen, all Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem and King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you. So the Spirit of God fell on the man, and he speaks. Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed at this great horde, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow go down against them. Behold, they will come up by the ascent of Ziz. You will find them at the end of the valley, east of the wilderness of Jeruel. You will not need to fight in this battle. Stand firm, hold your position, and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid and do not be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, and the Lord will be with you. So they prayed. We just read the answer. What's their response? Verse 18. Then Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground. And all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell down before the Lord worshiping the Lord. And the Levites and the Kohathites and the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. And they rose early in the morning. So it's a new day. And they went out into the wilderness of Tekoa. And when they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, Judah, and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be established. Believe his prophets, and you will succeed." And when he had taken counsel with the people, he appointed those who were to sing to the Lord and praise him in holy attire as they went before the army. That's kind of an unconventional battle plan, isn't it? Sending out the singers before the army. And say, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his steadfast love endures forever." Now we get to the battle itself. Verse 22. "And when they began to sing and praise, the Lord set an ambush against the men of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, so that they were routed." How'd that happen? "For the men of Ammon and Moab rose against the inhabitants of Mount Seir." So there's three parties, and two rise against the one, devoting them to destruction. "And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, they all helped to destroy one another." So the army just kills itself. Verse 24. "When Judah came to the watchtower of the wilderness, they looked towards the horde. And behold, they were dead bodies lying on the ground. None had escaped. When Jehoshaphat and his people came to take their spoil, they found among them in great numbers goods, clothing, precious things, which they took for themselves until they could carry no more. They were 3 days in taking the spoil. It was so much. On the fourth day, they assembled in the valley of Berachark, for there they blessed the Lord. Therefore, the name of that place has been called the valley of Berachark to this day. Then they returned, every man of Judah and Jerusalem and Jehoshaphat at their head, returning to Jerusalem with joy. For the Lord had made them rejoice over their enemies. They came to Jerusalem with harps and lyres and trumpets to the house of the Lord. And the fear of God, the dread of God, came on all the kingdoms of the countries when they heard that the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. So the realm of Jehoshaphat was quiet, for his God gave him rest all around." That was a lot of verses. You know, you read this through without really meditating, and one of the first things that should pop out is the chapter starts with Jehoshaphat afraid. The chapter ends with them rejoicing over their enemies. It ends with their enemies being in dread of them. What happened between that matters to me as a Christian. I don't know about you, but there are great hordes, not of physical men, but great hordes that I get word about all the time that are coming against me. There are great hordes that we as a church hear about that come against us. How do we respond? How do we get from a place of some being afraid to the place of rejoicing over our enemies and our enemies being in dread fear of us? I mean, that's a switcheroo we want to happen. I'm afraid, but by the end they're terrified, not of us, but of our God. So this chapter matters. This verse 12 has meant so much to me. Let's read that again. I'm going to deal with the whole chapter, but verse 12 specifically. You know, at the end of Jehoshaphat's prayer, I mean, he's ordering, arguing in his prayer before the Lord, and then it just like he cries out, "O our God, will you not execute judgment on our enemies, for they are many?" And then he says two things that I feel as a Christian often. He says, "For we are powerless against this great horde, and we do not know what to do." I mean, how many times have you been in a spot where you may even say that exact phrase, I don't know what to do. You know, I searched in my email with quotes around it to get the exact phrase, and I had 80 email threads where that exact phrase was in an email. I don't know what to do. And I read through many of them. People didn't, they had a problem. They didn't know what to do. They had no plan. How do I handle this? Then the other word, powerless. I mean, has anyone here ever felt powerless? Because we are powerless. That's a fact. He's not wrong. He's acknowledging the truth about ourselves. So with that said, let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you that we can say, are you not God, against whom none can withstand you? None can take you down. Lord, I thank you that you're God. And we can say, did you not say, like David taught in the Sunday school, that you who began a good work in us will bring it to completion? Did you not say so many promises, Lord? And so, Lord, in light of yourself, even here in this sermon, Lord, will you not help me to feed your sheep? Lord, that is my great desire, why I want to go to this passage. Lord, I want any of the brothers and sisters here today who may feel powerless in some circumstance, who may not know what to do. They have no plan with some specific enemy or trial that is before them. Lord, I want them to leave here today knowing we do have something to do. And Lord, that is to put our eyes on you. And so, Lord, would you feed your sheep today? Would you strengthen those who are weak? Would you give grace? And Lord, even as mentioned earlier, I pray you give grace to Raul, that you'd help him, you'd encourage his heart. Lord, all of us, Lord, we are faced with so many great hordes. Would you help us, Lord, to trust you in faith? I ask this in Christ's name. Amen. So the name of the sermon is, we are powerless, but God is all powerful. We're powerless. We see that, verse 12. But we also see the other half, God is all powerful. We saw that in his prayer in verse 6. Second sentence in verse 6, in your hand, or the third sentence, in your hand are power and might, so that none is able to withstand you. Powerless, but in your hand are power. I'm thankful we see that here. So we're going to look at this. Look at verse 12. One thing that's been such an encouragement or rebuke to me is this. Verse 12, he says this, O our God, will you not execute judgment on them, for we are powerless against this great horde that is coming against us. We do not know what to do. How many of us stop right at that point? I'm powerless, I don't know what to do, and we just kind of stop. What does Jehoshaphat do? What's the very next word? But, nevertheless, though this is true, but what? He says, but our eyes are on you. We all know that. We all know when the trials are coming, we need to put our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to look at in this text what that actually means. But we're also going to consider this. How many times we don't put our eyes on the Lord? How many times in the midst of a trial, though we know it's the thing to do, we just don't do it? We don't set our eyes on the Lord. Or we do and we say we did, but we really didn't set our eyes on the Lord. And again, we're going to see what that looks like in the text. So here the first thing, I think, to get help, we've got to realize. We've got to realize what is the truth about ourselves. We've got to. How many problems we have from wrongly assessing ourselves. Paul said, don't think highly of yourselves, but think with a sober judgment, each according to the measure of grace that God has given him. So how should I think about myself? So first, we're going to consider our weakness. We're going to consider our weakness. Verse 12 again. We see it right here. Jehoshaphat, at the end of his prayer, he says the honest truth. He says we are powerless. Powerless. What does it mean to be powerless? That word has part of its root in the word just meaning nothing. We're powerless. We're nothing. And I thought, what's an illustration to help there? And at first I thought of a laptop. But there's a problem with a laptop. What happens when I unplug my laptop from the battery? Is the laptop powerless? It's not. Laptops have a built-in battery. So when you unplug it, it's not powerless. It has power for a season. And then it's going to get plugged in. So for a little while, it can be self-reliant. It can rely on its own power. That's not us. The text doesn't say that of us. We're like a desktop computer. That's what I do my work on. And you know what happens? If you hit that power strip and you turn it off, you know what happens to a desktop computer? When you pull the plug, it doesn't do anything. It has no power at all. That's what's true of us. The Christian, we've got no power in and of ourselves. We're powerless. We find this throughout the Scripture, 2 Corinthians 4:7. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show something, that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. Imagine if this is a jar of clay. It's not, but imagine if I put that here. And imagine if I asked all of you to take a rock. You guys hopefully don't have rocks on you. Take a rock out and every one of you throw your rock at this bottle right now. You know what it would take for that jar of clay to not crumble? It'd take a miracle. And that's what Paul says. If that us, a jar of clay, if we, the Christian who have the truth, if we make it, you know the one thing it's going to show the world? You know the one thing, if you all pick a rock up and throw it at a jar of clay and it somehow survives 300 rocks, you know what that's going to show? It's going to show the power belongs to God. And that's what the text says. The power belongs to God and not us. Later in 2 Corinthians, Paul said it. He said, the Lord told me that His power is made perfect in weakness. What's Paul's response? Therefore, if that's true, I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness in order that the power of Christ may rest upon me. If I don't boast in my weakness, Paul says the power of Christ won't rest upon you. If I stand in my own strength, in my own power, if I say to myself, you know what, this is not powerless, I can handle that. Paul says right there, the power of Christ is not going to rest upon you. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And the Lord wants us there. He wants us dependent on Him. So people feel powerless. Someone emailed me. They said this, I feel myself too weak, feel too powerless to love God with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my strength, and feel too powerless to love neighbors as myself. I feel powerless in all these things. Someone else said, I've experienced such depression and feelings of being unworthy, powerless, and caught up in something that was hopeless that I've wanted to die. People feel it. People feel their powerlessness. Again, Jehoshaphat here, he didn't stop there. If you stop at I'm powerless and you go no further, there's a problem there. Unbelief. If you acknowledge your powerlessness and you add that nevertheless, though that's true, nevertheless, my eyes are on you, then that's faith. A lot of times we stop short of faith with unbelief. So, what else does he mention here? Verse 12. We're looking at our own weakness. We've got to see our weakness, because not seeing that is one of the things that prevents us from going to the Lord as we should when the great hordes come against us. So we've got to accurately assess ourselves and be honest. The second problem is we often don't know what to do. We don't have a plan. It's like, I don't know what to do. I mean, this great horde is coming. How much is that great horde? couple chapters earlier, we hear about a great multitude. You know how many that great multitude was? A million. A million men. He doesn't say how many is here, but a great multitude there is a million. This is a couple chapters later. This could be anywhere up to a million men coming. That's a lot. How do I respond to that? They say, I don't know what to do. Now, this is what Jehoshaphat does not mean. Jehoshaphat does not mean, I don't know what to do and I'm just going to crumble. I don't know what to do. There's no... No, what he means is this. This specific problem of a great horde of maybe a million men from three nations that's coming against us, Lord, I don't have a plan to defeat them and they're coming against us. That's what he means. And that's how it is for us. There are specific things. It doesn't mean in our whole lives, in every situation, we don't know what to do. Thank God we do know what to do if we look at His Word. Thank God we go to the Word and it's a light into our path. And we can see, the Lord says when I face this, I do that. So Jehoshaphat, the specific thing he doesn't know what to do is how do I defeat a million men from three nations that come against us? He doesn't have a plan. James 4:14. You do not know what tomorrow will bring. I don't know what tomorrow specifically going to bring with work, with life, my children's health. Romans 8:26. We do not know what to pray as we ought. You see, as Christians, there's a whole lot we just don't know. I mean, we don't know. I don't have an answer. I don't have a plan. But I do know what I should do, and that's put my eyes on the Lord. Someone emailed me. They said this, I hit rock bottom of my life. I see an end of my life with no hope. I don't know what to do. Is there a specific plan that the Word of God tells me to give this person who says that? There is. I can show them, yes, the Word does show you what to do if you hit rock bottom. Psalms 107 says, when you're at wit's end, when you're drawing near to the gates of death, it says, cry to the Lord in your distress, and He not might hear you, He will hear you and deliver you from all your distress. So I can give them that verse. That shows you what to do. Someone said, I can feel my heart hardening. I don't know what to do. Okay, is there any help? Is there something they can do? Sure, why is their heart hardening? I'd ask them that. They say, well, I've got known sin in my life. There's a right hand that causes me to sin, and I'm refusing to forsake that idol. And so, yes, my conscience is not clear. Then I tell them, well, that's what you need to do. You need to take that off, look to the Lord, and follow Him. So often we say, I don't know what to do, and it's not that complicated if we know the Word of God. Someone said, I need help. I don't know what to do. I've watched endless videos on salvation. I've prayed and read books. I've asked my pastors. So again, two things. The feeling of powerlessness. Not the feeling. The reality of it. And the reality, I just don't know what to do. I don't have a plan in some specific situation. So that's our weakness. That is our weakness. I mean, what does Proverbs say? We should trust the Lord in how many of our ways? Part? No, all. Yeah. All our ways. You see, God wants that. He wants us recognizing the fact that I do not know. You know in James 4 where he says, I do not know what tomorrow brings? You know what the Bible says to the person who says they know what tomorrow will bring? You know what it says they're doing? It says that boasting is evil and arrogant. It's sin. We just don't know. God wants us there. But He wants us there not to fall into despair, but to look to the Lord. So He doesn't stop there. If you see in verse 12, you know, you could circle that word but right there. Nevertheless, but. Why? Well, but our eyes are on You. Anytime you're saying the terminology, I'm powerless. You know, you go to your wife, it's like, Bethany, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I just feel like I got to lay on the floor I can't go on. She should say, but James, but put your eyes on Christ. Now we're going to look at it though. A lot of times you hear that. I know. I hear that terminology. Put my eyes on the, but my eyes are on the Lord. And you just, what does that look like? What does it look like to say, but our eyes are on you? Now notice in verse 12, he says, but our eyes are on you. As in Jehoshaphat is presently doing that. So what we're going to look at is what does it look like for my eyes to actually be on the Lord? Not just to say the terminology, not just to say, okay, you're right, and then you go and you kind of throw up a 5-second prayer. It's like, well, I put my eyes on the Lord. We're going to see here it's a lot more intense than that. Not that God doesn't hear us in short prayers. First thing we need to realize back in verse 3, chapter 20, then Jehoshaphat was afraid. Then Jehoshaphat was afraid. What do you do when you're afraid? What is your initial response? My wife sees a cockroach, she's afraid, she runs. And that's a good response, maybe. What do you do when you're afraid? How do you respond? Look what he does here. Then Jehoshaphat was afraid and set his face. I mean, this is a very determined. He set his face to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast. You know how we set aside time as a church to do a week of prayer and fasting? That's intentional. We're setting aside time. He set his face here intentionally to seek the Lord. How intentional was it? Look what it says next. And he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judah. And Judah assembled to seek help. That's what we need, help against the great hordes we face. The principalities and powers and things and spiritual places. And they came from all the cities of Judah. They came to seek the Lord. So fasting. Why fasting? What's the deal with not eating food? With denying yourself? I mean, think about it like this. We're about to have a fellowship feast here today, right? We're going to line up 60 crock pots. Maybe some of you close to the door can smell it. And you may have an appetite right now, Glenn. You may be feeling, I'm hungry. I can smell that. You know what happens? What if I got up here right now and I told the church, brethren, the team in Mexico, they're kidnapped by the cartel. They just put out a video on YouTube saying they're going to kill them within 6 hours. What happens to your appetite? You don't. The last thing you're thinking about is food. And if we're so desensitized where we can just shove that to the side and think, I want to go eat a tons of food, then we need to examine our heart. But when we hear of a great multitude, when we hear of a vast enemy coming against us, if we were to hear of that actually happening, that would produce some type of response where it's like, forget the meal, let's pray. Let's seek God until we get an answer. Let's go before Him for help. So when things hit a crisis point, an empty stomach seems so small compared to the great horde coming against you. So, they declared a fast. You know, that's how fasting should be. The Pharisees, what'd they say? I fast twice a week. I mean, what's that? Fast, I mean, when you know, I'm going to seek God. I'm going to go to God. I need help. I need answers. I need You, Lord. I want to block out all these other things. I need You, Lord. So, that's what he did. They started there. Remember, we're looking at what does it look like for our eyes to be on You. Okay? Because all of you and me feel powerless at times and we don't know what to do. And we want to respond biblically. And we see that at the end of verse 12, it's by saying, nevertheless, our eyes are on You. But what does it look like for my eyes to be on the Lord? And he says here, their eyes are, as in they're presently putting their eyes on the Lord. And part of that is this corporate prayer meeting, is this corporate fasting. That's part of put what it means to put your eyes on the Lord in this situation. So, the next thing is prayer. Jehoshaphat prays in a way to put responsibility on God. He order and arguments in this prayer so beautifully. We need to learn to pray like he did. And the only way we'll learn to pray like he did is if we know the Bible. And he quotes scripture in here. Verse 9, he quotes something that was said. He quotes scripture, something that Solomon said. So we need to know our Bible. So I want you to notice briefly with me, starting in verse 6. I want you to catch part of this flow. Verse 6, he says this, O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? So he's saying, are you not? Then he goes on, look at verse 7. Did you not? So again, he's saying, he's praying to the Lord. He's arguing his case. Look at verse 10. Little over, he says, whom you would not let us go out against. Then in verse 12, again, he's going to the Lord. O our God, will you not do this and that for us? And then verse 12 at the end, he says, because we do not know what to do. You see, all if we look at this, this isn't some accident. This man is thinking, what is the best? I mean, I've got to think of the truth I can put before the Lord. I want to lay hold of him. I want him to hear me. It's not a short prayer. It is short, I'm sorry. It's 12, couple verses, but it's really in depth with his content. So the first thing to put responsibility on the Lord, to argue his case to the Lord, is found in verse 6. He says this, O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? You rule over all. That's encouraging, great horde coming. Lord, you rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. But Lord, we're powerless. In your hand are power and might, so that none is able to withstand you. Great horde is coming. I put my eyes on the Lord. I am first reminding myself of this. Lord, are you not such and such? Are you not the God who split the Red Sea? Are you not the God who did this or that or that? Are you not the God who saved Saul of Tarsus? So what is it to you, Lord, to save my family member? Lord, are you not the God who raises the dead? So what is it you to raise them from spiritual death? We're powerless, but you're the God who has all power. I mean, we read that part where he says, none is able to withstand you. The hard thing is to believe that in the midst when a million men stand against you. It's easy to believe that now. Where's my great horde? Maybe some of you do have great hordes in some way in the spiritual realm against you today. And you need to remind yourself of that. Are you not the God who has all power, all might, who none can withstand? You're reminding yourself, and then you're praying to the Lord. Lord, is this not true? Lord, for the sake of your name, your word says this. Defend your cause. Don't leave us defenseless. So we need to remind ourselves of who God is. None can withstand him. Secondly, verse 7, he remembers what God has done in the past and what God has promised. Verse 7, did you not, Lord, are you not? And did you not, our God, drive out? I mean, Lord, they're coming to drive us out, but didn't you drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? When my daughter comes to me, it's like, Dad, didn't you give me the toy? And that person, they went and they ripped it out of my hands. Well, I love my daughter. I want to get her toy back. I want to fight for her. I want to help her in her situation of helplessness. And the child says that, Dad, did you not say to me that we would go to the zoo today? Did you not tell me that? They argue a case. You can't blame them. If we give our word, they should. That's right. And the Lord wants the same of us. He goes on here. Verse 8, and they have lived in it and have built for you in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, so what was said? Solomon had said, if disaster comes upon us, the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine. So this is what the word says, O God. Then it says, we'll stand before this house and before you, for your name is in this house, and we'll cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save. So right there, he's saying, Lord, Solomon said, if this happens, which it is, a great horde is coming against us, he said, this is what we're to do. Your word says we're to stand here before you and you'll hear us and save us. So his argument is, Lord, we're doing what you've commanded. We know your word. We're mighty in the scripture. And it says to do this. We're doing that, Lord. You said you would come and save us. You wrote that a couple chapters earlier. That's what we're doing. So, did not our God promise this land? And does not God's word say this? Remind yourself of scripture. We need to do that in a crisis. And do such just as they are. I mean, say you've got some sin in your life. Some sin. You're not getting victory over it. Is there a promise you can take to the Lord and say, Lord, did you not say that you would deliver me from every evil deed and bring me safely to your heavenly kingdom? Did you not say that the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly lust? Lord, did you not say that your grace would supernaturally train me to denounce worldly lust, to live a self-controlled, upright, and godly life in the present age? Does not your word say that? But Lord, I've got this thing in my life that I'm not getting victory over. But your word says you've come to train me to do that by your supernatural grace. So Lord, will you not do that? Are you not the God who said that in your word? That's that. We're going to lay hold of God when we pray like that. And that's exactly what he does. So, did not God, does not the Word. Next, he goes on here, verse 10. And now behold, the men of Amnon and Moab and Mount Seir, who you would not. Notice he's saying, Lord, you would not let Israel invade when they came from the land of Egypt and whom they avoided and did not destroy. Behold, they reward us by coming to drive us out of your possession, which you have given to us to inherit, O God. You gave it to us. You know what he's doing there? He's saying, Lord, our obedience to you in the past is why we're in the present circumstances we are. You didn't let us kill them before, and now they've amassed a great multitude, and they're coming against us. What a great thing. Lord, here, I'm over in the middle of this foreign country and things are getting really rough. And Lord, you would not let me not come here. So I'm here. You've put me here. You've brought these circumstances on me. So are you not the God who none can withstand? Come for my defense. I'm powerless. I don't know what to do. I don't have a plan. But Lord, you put me in this situation. You wouldn't let me do that. I mean, if there's some time God clearly doesn't let you do something, and then later on it comes, it seems like it's going to bite you back. You know, you were not able to even use money in a certain way, and then later it looks like it's going to bite you. You go to the Lord. Lord, you would not let me use that money for that need, but you had me give it to the orphans. All I did was obey you. I'm in this present financial crisis out of obedience to you. You whom would not let me. So, Lord, you're going to provide. You see, again, we're looking at what it means to have our eyes on the Lord. This is not a small thing. This is big stuff. This is thinking through. This is knowing our Bibles. This is knowing the character of our Father. So, next, look what he does. verse 12, he says, O our God, will you not execute judgment on them? You know, it's like, Lord, you've brought this great horde. And so we're going to stand back, and we need you to execute judgment. We're powerless. We don't have a plan to defeat that army. We do not know what to do. Oh, our God, will not you come to our defense? Will not you raise your right hand that is all powerful, that is almighty? Will not you fight for our cause? Lord, you've promised these saints. We're trusting that you're responsible to execute and to act on our behalf. I mean, that is putting your eyes on the Lord. So, are you not God? Did you not say? Does not your word say? And would you not let us do that? And Lord, will you not? Because we do not know what to do. You see that? Hope you followed that. That's his prayer. Lord, we're powerless. Psalms 37:5. Forgot it. Who knows Psalms 37:5? Oh, commit your way to Him. Trust in Him and He will act. He will act. That's what they're doing. They're trusting themselves in the Lord. Lord, act and execute judgment. Give us a plan. This is too big for us. Give us a plan. And they're putting their eyes on the Lord. They're not falling into despair. They're not falling into self-pity. They're falling into the everlasting arms of God. So that is what it looks like right here in this prayer. This is a practical example of what it means for our eyes to be on the Lord. So when someone tells you looking to Jesus, when someone tells you put your eyes on the Lord, you've got a practical example right here of what that looks like. Because he said our eyes are on you. They're doing that. They're actually doing that right there. So I hope that helps. Now, is the prayer meeting over? He closes right there, verse 12. What do they do? Disperse? No, look what it says, verse 13. Meanwhile, all Judah stood before the Lord. And I just take that to mean they waited before God. And look, they did it with their little ones, their wives, and their children. They just waited there. They stood before the Lord. Lord, we've prayed. But if you don't answer, we're dead. Lord, please help. Verse 14, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehazel in the midst of the assembly. Verse 15, he prophesied and he told them, thus says the Lord to you. Now, notice the phrases earlier. Are you not, did you not, you would not, will you not, we do not. And now look what the Lord's response to us is. Thus says the Lord, do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed at this great horde, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow go up down against them. Behold, they will come up the ascent of Ziz. You will find them at the end of the valley, east of the wilderness of Jeruel. You will not, there we have it again, need to fight in this battle. Stand firm, hold your position, and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. O Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, and the Lord will be with you. So, God answers. He says, do not be afraid. What does perfect love do? Cast out all fear. You know why we fear? What's fear? Yeah, lack of faith, unbelief. I'm afraid what's going to happen, which means I'm not trusting God. We got to take our fears to the Lord like He did. It's unbelief. Perfect love cast out all fear. If I'm really believing in God's perfect love for me in Christ, if I'm really believing His promises for me, guess what that's going to do? It's cast out all fear. It's going to take fear away. Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. That word dismayed, it means to be shattered. Have you ever felt like that? You just feel shattered. It's like you just crumble. And here he says, do not be shattered. I thought of Isaiah 41:10, another glorious verse with promises. Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Behold, all who are incensed against you shall be put to shame and confounded. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. It's a really good reason to not be afraid, to not be dismayed. We've got promises like this in our Word, the Word of God. Next, what does he say here in the answer to prayer? For the battle is not yours, but God's. And then he says, verse 17, you'll not need to fight in this battle. Think of something incredibly intimidating that you don't know how to do. Say someone says, build a house from ground up. Put down the rock, put down the pipes, put down the slab, frame. I only know how to do it, so I don't know all the process. Say they say that to you. What do you know what you say? I don't know what to do. I don't know how to plan. I don't know how to do that. Then think of this. Imagine someone comes along like the Lord does here, and they say to you, they say, oh, don't worry about it. The battle is not yours, it's mine. The house is not yours to build, it's mine. You know what I want you to do? I want you to sit over there and just watch me build the house on your behalf. That's what happens right here. We see that. For the battle is not yours, but God's. You will not need to fight. What are we going to do? Stand firm, hold your position, and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. What an encouragement. So, I mean, Zephaniah, it says, the Lord your God is in your midst. He is a victorious warrior. God is a victorious warrior. Now, we get an answer to prayer. You know one place now we go wrong? Some of us, great horde is coming. I'm powerless. I don't know what to do. And we genuinely put our eyes on the Lord. We seek God. We lay hold of God. But you know what then happens? He gives us an answer. Now, do you know what the next step is? What do we do with what He's told us to do? I'm telling you, there's times you get a clear answer from the Lord, and in unbelief, you stay, not in faith, obey. And that's the next test. Will they obey what has been said from the Lord? And they go above and beyond in faith. Notice what happens. Verse 18. Then Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, they fell down before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Doesn't say they started sharpening their swords. They went and worshiped the Lord. Then he goes on. So some fell down and worshiped. The Levites and the Kohathites and the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. So they get an answer, and they just start praising God. Now, you know what comes to your mind when you read that? You think, whoa, wait a minute. That great horde that you're powerless against, it's still coming at you. It's not gone yet. You're having a celebration victory a little early. The game's not over. But there's a big difference between a man on a basketball team bragging that we're going to win, and then they get decimated, and the living God who cannot lie, and in whose hand is all might and power, in whom none can withstand. There's a big difference between that arrogant man and the living God who makes a promise. And so it's absolutely right to take God at His word and start worshiping and praising the Lord. Because if I really believe what He's told me, that He's going to fight for us and the battle is His, then how could you not respond in worship to God? So it's not premature, it's faith. Too often, you know what our problem is? We wait until we see the physical fruition of what God has told us, and then we praise Him. We need more faith that when it seems like God has made it clear He's going to do that, we need to believe Him before we see it come to pass. We need to praise Him before it comes to pass. That's kind of risky. You may look like a fool to be praising God. And sure, we can presume. Some people presume. I've presumed on the Lord wrongly. But at the same time, we don't want that to scare us away, that when God makes it clear through His Word that this is going to happen, we've got every reason to praise God right then and right there, even before we see it with our eyes. Is that not what we're doing as Christians? We're going to a heavenly city. How many of you seen heaven? None of you. How many of you physically seen Christ? None of you. Yet we're believing in Him. We're going by faith and conquering kingdoms. We're trusting in the Lord. I'm not to heaven yet, but you know what I'm already busy doing? I'm rejoicing all the time I'm saved. Isn't that a little risky? No, like David taught in the Sunday school, God will persevere me to the end. It would be wrong if I just sat here trembling in fear. Does He love me? Does He not? Does He love me? Does He not? But to have confidence that God so loved me that He gave Himself for me. He did not spare His own Son. How much more will He not graciously with Him give us all things? That's faith. The opposite is unbelief. So, let's go back. What happens? The next day comes, and they rose early in the morning. I don't know about you. There's sometimes I'm at a prayer meeting, and I hear someone lay hold of God on the salvation for someone, and I really believe, man, the Lord heard that brother. God's going to do something. But you know what one of the tests is? The very next day. What's going to happen the very next day? What's going to happen when the new morning comes and I wake up and I want to go back to bed and I'm just dead? What happens? So here they rose early in the morning, a new day. And Jehoshaphat, he was a good leader. And they went into the wilderness of Tekoa, and when they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, you can just picture him rallying the troops, and he says this, "Hear me, Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be established. Believe His prophets, and you will succeed." I've got to do that every day. I've got to keep believing. You've got to keep believing the Lord. We've got to remind ourselves, I need to take God at His word. He is no liar. He is all truthful, all faithful. He will never lie. So, now what we find next is we get the battle plans. So here we've got a great horde, maybe a million people. And we're gonna get some battle plans. How's this going to go down? What is going to happen? I mean, this has got to be pretty amazing. Maybe He'll trim us down to 300 like Gideon's. Maybe we'll walk around the city and the walls will fall like Jericho. I mean, God's going to do something here to show how powerful He is and how powerless every foe is. He's going to do something here to really just magnify Himself where all mouths are shut and men fear God and know that He is Lord. So, very unconventional battle plans. Verse 21, when He had taken counsel with the people, He appointed those who were to sing to the Lord and praise Him in holy attire. And you kind of leave them in the back, right? You kind of give a pep talk to the troops, and then we'll send the troops out. You guys will stay back here and singing and helping the morale. Look what it says here. As they went before the army. And look what they're saying. And saying, give thanks to the Lord, for His steadfast love endures forever. I mean, here you might be going against a million people, and you're sending the singers first. And then they're singing, give thanks to the Lord, for His steadfast love endures forever. You know what the devil will slander in your mind right at that moment? He'll say, that's not true. God's going to fail this one time. No, His love's going to endure forever. It will not fail. It will not fail me. He began a good work in me. He's going to bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. He's promised these things. He will not fail. You know what the only way you would send the singers first before the army would be? People would look at that and say that is crazy. You know the only way you'll do that? Believe in God. You know the only way you're going to walk around the city until the blow trumps, until the walls fall? Believe God. You know the only way you're going to take 32,000 troops and narrow it down to 300 troops to go against an army that is more than the seas of the sand? Because you're believing God. And that's the only way. It's crazy to do otherwise. And you know what we learn from here? God wants that in our lives. It should not amaze us when we get put in really tight spots and something crazy happens where it's very risky, so to speak. The Lord does that. We see that through the entire Bible. He trims things down to make sure He gets not the most glory, all the glory. God's not looking to get the most. He wants all of it. He deserves all of it, and He's going to get all of it. So, verse 22. Here the singers are singing. They begin, they're singing and praising. Give thanks to the Lord. His steadfast love endures forever. And the Lord, remember who said He's going to fight the battle for them? The Lord, here the Lord's doing it. The Lord set an ambush against the men of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who had come against Judah so that they were routed. What does that ambush look like? Verse 23, for the men of Ammon and Moab rose against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, devoting them to destruction. So look at that. Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, those are the three armies that are coming against Judah. And now two of them attack the other one, and they devote them to destruction. And now go on. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, so those two armies kill Mount Seir, then what happens? They all help to destroy one another. So the other two kingdoms left kill each other. And here he says right here, verse 24, I mean, here we are, you know, we're intimidated, thinking, boy, this is just going to be a big trial. What's going to happen? And then look what happens. It wasn't that hard. It wasn't that difficult. When Judah came to the watchtower, you kind of feel intimidation. Lord, I'm expecting this is going to be such a great trial. And look what happens. They look towards the horde, and behold, they were dead bodies lying on all the ground. None had escaped. I mean, what? Look how kind the Lord is. It's like, don't draw your swords. I don't want you to lose a hair. Stand back here. I'm going to fight this battle for you. And you get to the watchtower, you look out, and the horde is dead. That great horde that you didn't know what to do anything about, that great horde that you felt that you were powerless against, God just takes it out like that. He doesn't even need you to pull a sword. He just needs you to sit in faith and praise Him and believe Him and go out there singing praises to God. And if they did that back in a day when there actually was a physical army killing others, and here we are in a day where we turn the other cheek and we're not going out there in war, Christians against non-Christians, how much more then in our day do we need to be singing and praising God? So, conclusion of the battle. Verse 25. When Jehoshaphat and his people came to take their spoil, they found among them in great numbers goods, clothing, and precious things, which they took for themselves until they could carry no more. They were 3 days in taking spoil. It was so much. So much. We're going to be in 3 hours of taking spoil from the crock pots during the fellowship feast. Imagine 3 days of taking food from crock pots. Imagine the spoil. What's the lesson here? I mean, here we are, the believer. Here you are, a great horde. You're powerless, but your eyes are on the Lord. The Lord reminds you, I'm going to fight for you. The battle is not yours, it's mine. You're my child. I will defend you. Yes, I've made promises to you. Yes, my word says this, and I will not fail. And you endure in that trial in faith. And you know what? One of the benefits of going through a trial and trusting God? Great blessing in the end. And they were blessed with 3 days of spoil. What trial have you been through? What great horde that has come against you has not in the end ended in great blessing? Great horde equals great blessing. So I better trust God. And again, we're not saying physical prosperity. God could help and physical things. But trials, they give provenness. They give more faith, endurance, strength. The Lord is kind to give us these. So, what are some encouragements we can take away? All right, real quick, let's read the end, I guess. Verse 26. On the fourth day, they assembled in the valley of Burkhark, for there they blessed the Lord. Therefore, the name of that place has been called the valley of Burkhark to this day. Then they returned, every man of Judah and Jerusalem and Jehoshaphat at their head, returning to Jerusalem with joy. For the Lord had made them rejoice over their enemies. And they came praising, and look at verse 29, and the fear of God came on all the kingdoms of the countries when they heard that the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. So the realm of Jehoshaphat was quiet, for his God gave him rest all around. Look, you may not feel rest all around today. You may feel great hordes all around today. And the Bible's word to you is to say, nevertheless, my eyes are on the Lord. I'm going to lay hold of the Lord. And as you do that, God will fight for you. God will give victory no matter the trial. And you're going to get rest all around. And once you got rest all around, guess what? Don't plan on it being for the rest of your life. Through much tribulation, you've got to enter the kingdom of heaven. The trials are going to keep coming. The fiery darts and the slanders and the lies of the enemy are going to keep coming. Where does Paul say our warfare is in 2 Corinthians 10? He shows us this in the mind. How much of our war is not against a physical man with a sword? Almost none of it is. It's against thoughts. We've got to take every thought captive. We've got to destroy every lofty imagination raised against the knowledge of God. That's our war so often. So, what encouragements can we take away? As already mentioned, when in faith you believe the Lord in the midst of a trial, a great horde, there's going to be great blessing. There's going to be spoil. Another thing, remember this. The Lord gives you trials not to be defeated, but so He can make you rejoice over your enemies. That's why He gives those. It may seem rough, but think at the end of it, you're going to be rejoicing over your enemies. And you wouldn't trade that for anything. One of my favorite verses, 2 Corinthians 1. Here you got the mighty apostle Paul. And he's like, Lord, I feel like I've received the sentence of death. Lord, I despair of life itself. And you know what Paul says? He says, this happened so I would no longer rely upon myself, but that I would rely on God who raises the dead. That's why one big reason trials come. God wants you on your face, not in despair, but your eyes towards the Lord. He wants you seeking Him. He wants us absolutely reliant on Him. We are that desktop computer. You pull the plug, John 15:5 says, apart from me, you can do nothing. We can't do something apart from God. We can do nothing apart from God. Too often we think we can do a little because we appear like we do. End of the day, only true fruit we have is in the power of God by the strength of Jesus Christ. Remember this. This is a good one to remember. Remember those who challenge the Lord's, that's us, are ultimately challenging God since He fights for us. I mean, that great horde's coming, oh, a little fear. But then I remember, you know who they're challenging? Not ultimately me, not my army, not my devices, which are, I'm powerless, I got nothing, I don't know what to do, I'm not a good planner. You know what? They're not ultimately challenging me. And my ultimate thing as a Christian is not there to pick myself up in my own strength. My thing is to look to the Lord who fights for me. So when the world, when the devil, when he comes after you, ultimately he's coming and God will fight him as a victorious warrior and he will win. He has no losses. He does not lose. Like David pointed out in John 10, none are going to get snatched out of the Father's hand. He won't fail. We fail in unbelief at times, not going to God as we should. Another encouragement. Again, it started in verse 3, Jehoshaphat was afraid. It ended that the fear of God came all upon all the enemies. And how often is that true? It starts with fear, and by the end, we just have joy and our enemies are afraid. We need to remember that will be the outcome. If you put your eyes on the Lord, if you trust Jehovah, if you trust God, that will be the outcome of that great horde. He doesn't say how long it's going to take in your specific battle, but the end of that battle will be that. The enemy will tremble at God. Not us, because we're powerless, at God. So, an application. How do you respond when you're powerless and don't know what to do? How do you respond when that happens? How do you respond when you feel I'm powerless, when you say I don't know what to do? Do you stop there? My hope is you will never stop there again, and this verse will be an intimate friend etched on your heart, so the very moment you're wanting to stop, you'll just hear that word, but nevertheless, it'll just be invading your mind, and you'll hear, but our eyes are on you. And you'll know, I got to go there, it's not easy, I got to go. It'll be harder to try to go through a trial without the help of the living God. So, you don't ever have to not know what to do. Overall, there's many things you will not know what to do specifically. But there will never be a point in the Christian's life where he absolutely does not know what to do. You're never going to get to a point where just you literally don't know anything to do. No, there's always one thing you can do, and that's put your eyes on the Lord. And we just looked at what that looks like. I mean, it's going and it's wrestling with the Lord like Jacob did until he blesses you. It's seeking God. It's forget about food. I'm going to fast. I'm going to you, Lord. So that is encouraging. So if I'm in a place where I really think I don't know what to do, then I need to believe God and turn to Him. Another application. Do you know God's promises in order to remind Him of them? God always fulfills His promises. I mean, take this prayer and look at those things. Are you not powerful? Did you not promise us the land? Did not your word say this? Was it not you who would not let us do such and such? Lord, will you not come for our aid? Lord, because we do not know what to do. And the Lord says, do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. The battle is not yours. It is mine. You will not have to fight. We got to know what's not and what's true. So, do I know God's promises to order and argument them in prayer? I mean, here an example. You take Revelation 5:9. He says here, by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. Lord, did you not say that? Did you not say you've ransomed people for God from every tribe? And Lord, there's that little tribe on a little island or in the middle of a big jungle. And Lord, you said you've ransomed people from that. So will you not raise up someone to go there, and will you not, once they're there, execute judgment upon the unbelief of those dark, demonic people and save one of them? Because you said in your word you're going to save someone from every nation, every tongue, every tribe. I can go to the Lord with authority in my prayer and confidence, not at all in myself, because I'm not saying, Lord, did I not say this? You know, Lord, did I not do this for you? Come on, look at my love for you. None of that. It's just, Lord, you said this, you did that, you would not let, will you not? We do not. Peter said, the Lord is not slow to fulfill His promise, in that case of the end, as some count slowness. May we not be the ones who count God slow to fulfill His promises. So, in closing, We may feel powerless because we are. So don't think it a bad thing. You see what I'm saying? I mean, I say that. We may feel powerless, but then I have to, well, wait a minute. We are powerless. It's like we feel powerless and our thing to do is to try to get power. But don't look to get power of your own. Go to the Lord for His power. That's the response. So we are powerless. But you know what this chapter shows us? Ultimately, God is all powerful and our enemies are powerless. We got to remember that. Don't just say, I'm powerless, I am. But then remember, God, You are all powerful, and to You, these enemies are so powerless, you can send the sinners first, just praising God, and Lord, You can wipe out that whole army just like that. It's nothing to You. This is nothing. That type of victory is a powerful statement. You know what the Lord's victory says? No weapon fashioned against you will stand. It says winning for the Lord is not a challenge. It's a challenge for me to do many things. For the Lord, that's just not the case. It's not a challenge. The Lord's not over there trying to think, what is a plan? I can't think of a plan. God knows. He does it. He's just like that. He's all powerful. So we're not powerless. We are powerless, but He is all powerful, and our enemies are the ones who are truly powerless at the end of the day. Jeremiah, but the Lord is with me as a dread warrior. Therefore my persecutors will stumble. They will not overcome me. They will be greatly shamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. You hear that? Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. Look, if you're lost here today, come on, please hear me. If you know you don't know the Lord, listen for a moment. You know what would be a shame? Is for you to hear about one who fights for others as our God. The one who is all-powerful. The one who has said many promises. You know what would be a shame? Is for you to not cast yourself on Him. You would join where Jeremiah says their dishonor will never be forgotten. To be invited to such a table where Jesus Christ stands and He says, you do not need to fight in the battle. He said on the cross, it's finished. He's saying, trust me. Come without money, without price. It's finished. It's done. But Lord, I want to go after one of them. At least, no, it's finished, Christ says. What a dishonor. What eternal shame to hear of this Christ and to say, I know what to do, and that's to live for my sin, because I believe the lie that sin will satisfy. And friend, sin will not satisfy. Sin will put you in hell. Sin will rot your bones. Sin, it doesn't satisfy. But this God we've read today, He'll satisfy your soul. He'll fight for you. Your promises will apply for Him, and you are powerless against the great horde of your sin. You cannot take your sin out. You have so much sin on your record, you stand as a legally condemned criminal. You need a perfect man to represent your case, and there's only one who can do it, and that's Jesus Christ. And He came as a man. He lived under the law. He fulfilled the law, and then He bore the penalty of the law in His death by suffering hell and wrath that you deserve. And He says, come to me, I'll give you my righteousness, I'll declare you legally righteous in my courtroom, and all that wrath will be removed because I bore it on the cross. You won't need to fight in the battle. What did He say in Jeremiah, or in 2 Chronicles? He says, stand firm, hold your position of not trusting in your own works, and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. That's all you got to do. Just stand firm. Put down your laboring, Matthew 11 says. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. Stop laboring. And just look and believe and see salvation that I have provided. So, if you're lost, do you say, I don't know what to do about my sin? I'll tell you, there is one thing you can do about your sin, and that you can go to Jesus Christ today. You can turn from all known sin in your life and surrender to Him, and He will abundantly pardon you. Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. I want to close with a quote of Jim Elliot. I was studying for this sermon and I picked up Jim Elliot's biography, The Shadow of the Almighty. I was about page 200 and he talked about the verse. So I thought the Lord wanted me to read this. Oh, for a faith that sings. Thought of Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles 20. Threatened with a defeat by a multitude that far outreached his powers of war, he set his face towards Jehovah. Then after an answer from a prophet, Jehoshaphat, himself humbled and believing, charges his people, believe in the Lord your God. And then they broke out singing in the face of such a problem. Lord God, give me a faith that will take sufficient fear out of me so that I can sing over the akuas. Father, I want to sing. And Jim Elliot did go before the akuas singing, and he got martyred. And that was not God missing it. That was God's divine will. Let's pray. Father, I really desire my own life, my brothers and sisters' lives, that we indeed would, when we hear the great hordes, when we hear the forces of darkness and things coming against us, Lord, that we would just be able to sing the steadfast love of the Lord endures forever. Lord, what more do we need? Your love is steadfast, ours is not. So Lord, give us grace. Lord, help us believe these things, apply these things. Help us to be better seekers of God. Help us, Lord, to pray better. Teach us to pray. The disciples asked that. I asked that. Lord, I long to hear more of order and argumenting in prayer in our prayer meeting. And so, Lord, are you not God who said you're going to sanctify us? You're going to work in us to will and to work for your good pleasure. And so, Lord, I pray and I ask that you would. In Jesus' name, amen.